There's gold in them thar hills. My name is Benjamin Willis. Colorful Colorado may be known for its natural beauty, but over the centuries, there has been a lot of treasure lost in these rugged mountains. Legend has it that somewhere in southwestern Colorado, there is a solid gold statue cast in the likeness of baby Jesus. Standing nearly 4 feet tall, it is hidden in a cliffside cave or crevice in the La Plata Mountains. The icon was hidden by Spanish explorers returning from the La Salle Mountains in Utah. They planned to stay the winter in Santa Fe, but the deadly cold overtook the Rockies. The golden Jesus, weighing several hundred pounds, had to be hauled in a specially built wagon. Native Americans attacked and killed a majority of the Spaniards. The wagon with the golden Jesus slipped away. Reportedly 4 miles from the scene of the attack, the Spaniards recognized escape was impossible with their large cargo. Earliest translated accounts contend it was hidden in a small cave, though modern researchers theorize a large crevice located on a bluff conceals the treasure. Accounts of what became of the 4 surviving Spaniards vary. Some say all 4 returned to Spain, while others claim 2 died in a final attempt to retrieve the golden icon. Then 100 years later, in 1873, a wagon train from Illinois happened on an emancipated prospector wandering aimlessly near present-day Hesperus, Colorado. The delirious man told of finding a golden statue too heavy for him to move, so he sealed up the cave entrance with even more stones to hide it until his return. Incapacitated by his illness, the frontiersman died before the settlers reached a doctor. The golden Jesus was lost again and awaits discovery by a lucky treasure hunter. In the late 1700s, French explorers lost so much gold around Wolf Creek Pass that the peak south of here, where it's believed the loot is buried, is now called Treasure Mountain.
Legend tells of a group of French explorers that came to the area in the late 1700s, in search of wealth. It's said they found gold. Lots of gold. For whatever reason, the French explorers hid the gold in the wilderness, drawing a map to the caches. But before they could continue their exploration, the party was attacked by Indians, with most of them being killed. 5 men survived the attack, but they were left battered and without any provisions. The survivors headed to an outpost in Kansas, but the brutal conditions forced them to turn to cannibalism to survive. When they finally made it to the outpost, only 2 were left. 1 died, which left only 1 person with knowledge of the location of the hidden gold. The man, known as LeBlanc, returned to France. As the story goes, he made a copy of the map, giving 1 to the French government and keeping the original. Eventually, LeBlanc returned to the southwest to recover the lost treasure. He hired a guide named Bernardo Sanchez. After setting out into the wilderness, Bernardo returned alone. People became suspicious, even going so far as to try Bernardo for LeBlanc's murder. He was eventually acquitted, and the legend of what happened to the Frenchman's lost gold grew. Over the years, maps have surfaced that are said to point the way to the lost treasure. For centuries, People have ventured into the mountains around Wolf Creek and Treasure Mountain, but no one has come forward to claim they've discovered the gold. New chapters continue to be added to the legend. In the 1990s, it was said that some hunters sought shelter in a cave in the area. They discovered that the cave was man-made. After some exploring, they found their passage blocked by a cave-in. When they tried to tunnel through, they were attacked by rattlesnakes. After the snakes came bats, and even a huge owl that seemed to be protecting whatever was hidden in the cave. Eventually, the hunters fled. As far as anyone knows, the gold those Frenchmen found all those centuries ago is still out there. Most people come to the area around Wolf Creek to ski, but if you plan a visit, maybe take a hike around Treasure Mountain. You never know.
Somewhere near the rocky outcrops of Los Animas in southern Colorado, near present-day Walsenburg, fleeing Spanish pioneers hit a large cache of gold bars. Around 1823, a procession that included 8 golden-laden mules departed for Mexico City. Shortly after departing, the Spanish were set upon by Ute warriors. Certain of their demise if they didn't put some distance between them and the warriors, those in the caravan buried the heavy hoard of gold weighing them down. The decision was made too late, and only 3 men escaped to safety in Santa Fe. The wounded trio never returned. The gold is said to be buried not far from a memorable grouping of boulders the Spanish called the Doll, which refers to the shape of a rocky outcrop standing 30 feet high. The unique formation is supposedly on the northwest slope of West Spanish Peak near La Veda, a short drive from US Highway 160. The survivors indicated the gold was buried someplace above the Purgatory River, 8 to 10 miles east of Los Animas. Contradictory historical records place the treasure nearer East Spanish Peak, which is accessible via Aguilar off of Interstate 25. $100,000 in gold was stolen by bandits who buried their loot in a gulch east of Clifford in Lincoln County. The spot was marked by 3 stones, each carved with the date 1847. The story gained credence decades later when a flat stone carved with 1847 was found in the area.
Today we're going to Grand County, Colorado, to look for the California miners' hidden golden cache. In the early 1850s, a handful of successful miners from the California gold fields attempted to return home. Unfortunately, the miners didn't consider 2 of the largest obstacles that stood in the way: the Continental Divide and the hostile Ute, Cheyenne, and Arapaho Indians. By the time the party had reached Grand Lake, Colorado, about 30 miles north of present-day Boulder, 2 of the members had already been killed in running battles with the Indians. As they reached the mountains of the Divide, the increasingly rugged landscape was impeding their progress. The men knew the hundreds of pounds of gold they were carrying was holding up the progress of the escape and was becoming a liability. They decided to bury most of the gold. It was placed in cast iron Dutch ovens and buried down by the lake near a large boulder on the eastern shore. Further marked the spot, a miner drove his sheath knife into a large spruce tree whose shadow fell on the rock at a certain time of day. The men had planned to return the following spring, better prepared after things had calmed down with the Indians. Soon after, they broke camp and started to move. The Indians attacked again, this time killing all the miners but one, who managed to escape. He returned home to tell the story of the treasure, but died that winter. His kin organized a search party to look for the treasure, but they were never able to find the knife that marked the location, and along the eastern shore, they could find no signs of treasure. Could an old sheath knife still be stuck in a spruce tree on the eastern shore of Grand Lake? Or could someone have passed by noticing the knife, pulling it from its location, not knowing its significance? Likely the latter. But if so, the treasure's still there.
An outlaw gang calling themselves the Bloody Espinosas robbed and terrorized settlements all throughout the San Luis Valley. They would bury their loot on the slopes of Pikes Peak in Ute Pass near present-day Cascade, Colorado. The Bloody Espinosas were all killed by a cavalry scout before they could claim their treasure. A stagecoach near tiny Virginia Dell Station just south of what is now the Wyoming border in today's Laramie County was robbed. A wagon containing an Army payroll of $60,000, over $2.5 million in today's value, was robbed by six thieves. The outlaws were quickly set on by a motivated cavalry unit dispatched from the Wyoming Territory. They had no choice but to quickly bury the gold with the hope of circling back after losing the cavalry. That was not their destiny, as the running shootout culminated violently, leaving the location of the loot a mystery to this day. The only evidence that the payroll existed was an empty strongbox found abandoned beside a creek bed. The robbery took place 1 mile from Virginia Dell Station at Longview, with the gunmen reportedly riding west toward moderately wooded foothills. Nearby Table Mountain was the site of a cabin the locals called Robber's Roost, situated a couple miles northeast of Virginia Dell Station. It sat atop a steep cliff, providing the inhabitants advanced warning of approaching lawmen. Today, Virginia Dell Station is located 45 miles northwest of Fort Collins on County Road 43F, 1 mile east of U.S. Highway 287. It is a starting point for treasure seekers looking to unearth the lost loot. The Reynolds gang stole over $100,000 from banks, mines, stagecoaches, and ranch robberies, encompassing the pro-Union Colorado territory between Canyon City and Como. However, when confronted by a large posse, rather than allowing their plunder to fall into the hands of their pursuers, they buried the treasure somewhere near Kenosha Pass, Fairplay, Como, or Conifer, close to Deer and Elk Creeks. General D.J. Cook theorizes that the treasure is hidden in Hall Valley near Grant. Local historians are not sure, believing it is buried closer to Deer Creek about 5 miles from Schaefer's Crossing near U.S. Highway 285. One of the Reynolds brothers stated on their deathbed, "You go above Geneva Gulch a little ways and you'll find where one of our horses mired down and we had to leave it here. At the head of the gulch, you turn to the right and follow a mountain around a little farther. And just above the head of Deer Creek, you'll find an old prospector shaft running back into the mountains about a timber line. It's back there in a hole somewhere. We walled up the hole with stones." Jesse James buried some treasure in Half Moon Gulch, southwest of Leadville in Lake County. The incident took place in October 1880, when three prospectors made a startling discovery in a remote mountain cavern in south-central Colorado. The trio found themselves about 2 miles north of what's known today as Dead Man's Camp. To escape an approaching blizzard, S.J. Hartman, H.A. Melton, and E.J. Oliver took cover under a ledge at the mouth of a canyon. Then one of them spotted an opening in the canyon wall, and they all squeezed through to safety. Lighting their torches, they followed a corridor leading to a chamber about 20 feet long. Scattered across the earthen floor were the bones of a skeleton. They would eventually find five skeletons, and no clues to their identity. Several tunnels branched off the room, so the prospectors chose one and headed deeper into the cavern. When they reached a large vault-like area, they noticed several man-made shelves had been carved into the western wall. On the shelves sat a collection of odd-shaped stones, which, upon closer examination, were crude bars of gold. Excited by their find, They waited until the storm abated, took 5 of the gold bars, and left. They arrived in Silvercliff, in the Wet Mountain Valley, to have their discovery appraised. The bars were valued at $900 apiece. According to the Denver Post, the prospectors became instant celebrities. The men were pressured for the location of the cave, but they clammed up. They made plans to return in the spring. As the small expedition made its way back, each of the prospectors were excited by the potential of great riches. However, they couldn't locate the entrance to the cave. In fact, the entire area didn't even resemble the original surroundings. The Fair Play Flume, a local newspaper, wrote, "The men slipped off in the spring, but they never found the Dead Man Cave. They frequently returned. Many others went back frequently, but nobody found anything." As far as anyone knows, the gold bars of Dead Man's Cave still await discovery, sitting along the shelves inside the mysterious hidden cavern. Hauling $100,000 in gold and silver coins from a bank robbery, the Butch Cassidy gang had a posse hot on their trail, so they buried the loot near Monument, Colorado, but never had a chance to return for their stash. Butch Cassidy and his wild bunch often rode into the remote valley of Brown's Hole to escape lawmen. Butch's girlfriend, Josie Morris, lived at Brown's Park on the Bassett Ranch. It is believed the gang stashed millions in gold there. Josie's cabin and remnants of Doc Parsons' cabin still remain to this day.
We're going to talk about 4 wagon loads of dimes that in 1907 left the Denver Mint, headed for Phoenix, Arizona. Somewhere along the way, the wagons, the drivers, and the dimes all disappeared, never to be seen again. 4 wagon loads of dimes left Denver, Colorado for Phoenix, Arizona, and they had a treacherous route ahead of them. Now these wagons were hauling freshly minted silver 1907 Barberhead dimes, and perhaps some 1907 quarters as well. Today, these dimes are very special, though over 4 million of them were struck from 90% silver and 10% copper bearing the D of the Denver Mint. Only about a dozen of these dimes in decent shape are known to still be in existence today. If you were to locate just one of these dimes in pristine shape, it could very well bring over $1,000. Of course, it is possible that the wagon train met with foul play from bandits along the trail. The most common belief today is that perhaps because of foul weather or some other reason, the wagon train fell victim to the very treacherous trails along the Black Canyon. Now, Black Canyon is a breathtaking place. In some places, the canyon's 1,000 foot wide and over 2,000 foot deep. And it owes its name to the fact that parts of the canyon only receive about 30 minutes of sunlight per day. That is an amazing place. Now, there are a few theories of what happened to the dimes. Some folks think that the wagon drivers made a bargain amongst themselves and just decided to ride off with the dimes and keep them for themselves. Some folks think that they were set upon by outlaws that knew about the shipment. But if either one of those things would have happened, these dimes would have showed up in circulation, and the 1907 Barberhead dime is one of the rarest. So that seems very unlikely. There are also some rumors that a few years ago, some hikers in Black Canyon found the remains of a few wagons and a couple of gallons of these dimes spread out amongst the wreckage. Could be, but that's just a drop in the bucket compared to what's missing. So there's still a lot of dimes out there to find.
Ben's fort along the old Santa Fe Trail is where millions in gold is supposedly buried. The Musgrove gang buried their silver and gold along the Cachalapoudre River. The loot from the Garfield County train robbery was buried somewhere near Grand Valley. A chest of gold was buried along Ralston Creek between Denver and Central City in Gilpin County, and it has never been recovered.
Now that's just a small example of the treasure we know about. There could be billions more out there that was just never reported or made it into the history books. So grab your shovels and metal detectors and... You know, I should be doing that myself. Oh, I'm Benjamin Willis. Thanks for watching.
In my job and I made up my mind to spend my life looking for gold. That old gold bug really bit me good, and I'm doomed, so I've been told. I got metal detectors up the old yin yang, gold dredge and a four-wheel drive. I'd be better if you shot me, 'cause gold fever's really got me, and I'm hooked as long as I'm alive. Gold.